This session today we would be talking about the global distribution of plants and animals across. So this would be one of the final topics in the section on biogeography. So what we would start is first the causes of distribution. We would then move to classification for distribution. Under classification we will cover two things: the terrestrial distribution for plants. So the terrestrial distribution for plants, and the next would be terrestrial distribution for animals. And finally, we would be covering the Vavilov's gene center concept. So let's start with the causes. So when I say the distribution of plants and animals, it is governed by various factors. The first one that we would be discussing is the climate factor, the amount of rainfall, precipitation, temperature and climatic conditions. You have edaphic factor that relates to soil, soil texture, soil porosity, the permeability and the concepts related to soil. Then you have biotic factors which governs the other life forms, be it the plants or the animals. Then the physical factors affect the rock structure, rock formation, type of rock. You have the tectonic forces. Are the tectonic factors which include continental drift, the formations or similarities on the coast of, say, west of Africa and the east of American region. So that's a kind of concept that we would be covering under plate tectonic forces, natural hazards, earthquake, volcano, tsunamis, and finally human induced or anthropogenic factors are some of the factors that affect distribution of plants and animals across the globe. Now, while covering the distribution of terrestrial plants, we would start with the first, that is distribution of plants, then we'll move on to animals. So when I talk about distribution of plant, this classification was given by Ronald Good. He explained an interesting concept. I could explain it by means of Venn diagram. So he said there is a region of phytochorion. This phytochorion is a region for a particular plant species and it has no physical boundaries, but wherever there is overlap between two phytochorion region, this region is known as the vegetation tension zone. So based on this phenomena, he tried to isolate individual areas, but specifically he said that each area has some transitional element and that transitional zone is known as vegetative tension zone. So let's understand the regions that were propounded by Ronald Good with means of this diagram. So the first region, which is the Australian region, covers the area of Australia, island group of New Zealand, Tasmania. You have few island groups with few islands of Indonesian group. Now, Australian region is further subdivided into northeast, southeast, southwest, and central. The central Australian region is also known as Eremia region. With this classification, he explained most of the factors that govern the Australian kingdom. Under this, he explained the vegetation pattern is mostly either temperate or desert in nature. So he tried to classify the cropping behavior based on the temperate and the desert. Now the list of all the crops which are covered in the various kingdoms are available in the postal course. You can refer those. We'll be just covering the very fundamental concepts here. The next is the South African kingdom. This is considered as the smallest region or the smallest classified region by Ronald Good. This region, although being the smallest region, has highest diversity with around 9,000 vascular plants, of which around 64% of those are endemic. Endemic means local to that area or specific to this area. So this is the South African region, which is very important. As I said, despite being the smallest region, it has highest diversity among all the regions of the world that he classified on. The next is Antarctica. This is considered as the southernmost region, covers the region south of South America. and the whole area of Antarctica. As the region suggests, it covers the South Pacific Ocean and the South Atlantic Ocean. This region does not have very huge range of plants here. So most of the plants here are covered would be in the like minor lichens and mosses. You have around 50 species or 50 families, I should say, not species, 50 families of plants which are specific to Antarctica region. Of these 50, around 20 to 25 are angiosperms. Angiosperms means they are flowering plants. The next kingdom that we would be discussing is Paleotropical. It covers the region of Africa, regions of Asia, including India, China. You have island group of Indonesia, Malaysia and Papua New Guinea. Also, it includes the island group of Hawaii, that is the Melanesian island group. So, this is the next region that we would be discussing. It has a huge diversity, as you can see here. So, there is a lot of diversity in fauna, but still this diversity is less as compared to the South African region. The next region that he demarcated was Neotropical region. It covers the Central America, regions of Mexico and Southern America. This region whole as a whole is considered a very important in the distribution of plant kingdom, the plant classification that was given by Ronald Good. This region, along with the Holo-Arctic region, comprises some of the major major floras of the globe. So this is the Neotropical region that we would be covering. It excludes some of the regions of Southern Florida, Caribbean island, that is excluded here. So all these, besides all these, are covered in the Neotropical range. The major crops that are common to this region are potato, tomato, cassava, then you have sweet potato, yam. Then we come to Holo-Arctic. Holo-Arctic includes the whole of the northern region. The predominant region would be pine or conifers here. So it includes Northern America island group of Greenland. You have the whole of United Kingdom, you have Denmark, then you have whole of the Russian and the Northern European belt, including Finland, Norway and the remaining island groups in the Atlantic Ocean. So this is considered as the Holo-Arctic kingdom. Most of the cropping pattern here is, again, as I said, pine and coniferous. We would be discussing the animal behavior in a separate classification that was given by Wallace. So this was the plant classification that was given by Ronald Good based on the concept of phytochore and vegetative tension zone which lie between this region. So this all, which is denoted by dotted line, is a kind of region where you can say there is a vegetative tension zone. Now there are various other classifications for plants that we categorize into. The first is based on moisture. So based on moisture, I can divide plants into four categories. You have hygrophytes that require a lot of water. Then you have mesophytes which require adequate amount of water. Troposphytes are the plants that grow in alternate wet and dry cycles. So you have alternate wet and dry cycles. And finally, you have nerophytes which have the capacity to grow in dry areas like cactus. The next is based on temperature. Again, you have four categories. Hecistotherms are those growing in cold areas. So they cannot tolerate a temperature that is higher than 10 degrees Celsius. That means they can grow into very low temperature. On the contrary to this, you have megatherms, which can grow only where the temperature is more than 18 degrees Celsius. So you have megatherms growing in hot areas in contrast to hecistotherms growing in cold areas. You have mesotherm, which has a range of 6 to 22, usually 6 to 18 on the colder side. Microtherm cannot tolerate a temperature below 6 degrees and above 22 degrees. So it has a narrower range. Now we come on to the distribution of plants, distribution of animals. We have already covered the distribution of plants based on various categories. When we talk about distribution of animals, the first and the foremost person who talked about the distribution was Wallace. He tried to propound a Wallace line, as you can see here, between the Oriental and the Australian zone, and he demarcated various regions based on the type of fauna that exists in that region. Now his two regions, Nearctic and Palearctic together, is known as Holoarctic. So I can say Palearctic and Nearctic is together known as Holoarctic, the similar one as given by Ronald Good for plants. So this whole region is considered as Holoarctic, and Ethiopian and Oriental region together is known as Paleotropical. So he combined these two regions as well, saying that this is Paleotropical region and this is Holoarctic region. So that was one thing that we need to know in this theory. Now let's go on to the individual regions. So let's talk about the Palearctic first. As you can see, it covers most of the Russian area and the North European area. The common animals that are found here are musk, polar bear and hedgehogs. So you have musk, polar bear, hedgehogs. Then you have Nearctic region, covering the region of North America and Greenland. You have the Neotropical region. Now this Neotropical region itself is important because it covers some of the very important animal species like armadillo. You have guenna, the guenna birds. So these are some of the very unique species that are covered in the Neotropical area. Then you have the Ethiopian region. Ethiopian region covers most of the species like zebra, giraffe, you have sloth, anteaters, and it is a kind of tropical area, so it has huge lot of fauna that exists here. Now there is a transition zone between Palearctic and Ethiopian region, which is known as the Saharan region. This region has Mediterranean type of climate. Then you have Oriental species, the Oriental region covering most of India and parts of China. This region is known for gorillas, chimpanzees. You have the Australian region. Australian region includes the region of Australia, Tasmania, parts of New Zealand here. And this region is known for marsupials. Marsupials are placental mammals, for example, kangaroo. You have wallaby. So these are some of the area, some of the animals that are common in the Australian belt. Finally, you have the New Zealand belt, and New Zealand belt is considered as a sub-region of Australian belt here, which has similar fauna species as to the Australian region. Now this was the classification that was propounded by Wallace for distribution of animals. Now there are various other classifications that were propounded, but before that it was K. Smith who tried to divide the regions that were given by Wallace into a much more organized fashion, and he said we could broadly classify the realms into three parts, that is Arctogen, pertaining to the Arctic region, Neogen and Notogen. So he said the Holoarctic hole of the top belt and the Paleotropical belt, which includes the Oriental and the Ethiopian region, together form the Arctogenic region. Just the Neotropical region forms the Neogenic region, and you have the Australian and the Oceanic region, which includes Australia, New Zealand, Papua New Guinea and the island groups including Antarctica, which forms the Notogen. So if I have a world map here, I can say the top area, that's the Arctogen, the bottom area, that's the Notogen, and you have the Neotropical area here. So that was a kind of simpler classification that Smith tried to provide, and this was, I think, given in 1954. Now this was one of the basic classifications which was a kind of replica from the Wallace classification. The next thing that we need to know is the various kind of classifications based on different parameters. So first, based on climate, he tried to divide into two groups, the stenohygric and the urehygric. Now first of all, let's learn the meaning of steno and ure. So wherever there is steno, that means pertaining to a very narrow range, while ure stands for pertaining to a wide range. So we are clear with the prefixes. Now let's move on to the suffixes. Hygric. Hygric means we are dealing with humidity. So if I am talking about based on humidity, a group of animals which can tolerate a very narrow range of humidity would fall under stenohygric, and animals which can tolerate huge range of humidity would fall under urehygric category. So this was based on climate. The next is based on food. Again, phagous means food. So those who can tolerate a very narrow range of food, like eating a specific plant species only, so that would be covered under stenophagous. While urephagous would include omnivorous species who can consume both plants and animals. So bears, for example, would be a classic example for urephagous animals. So that is another type of classification that we use for distribution of or classification of animals. The next classification that we can use is thermal. Thermal means temperature range. So these animals who can tolerate a very narrow thermal range, temperature range, in contrast to urethermals who can tolerate a very wide range of temperature changes. So stenothermal are further classified into thermophilic and cryophilic. Thermophilic are those which are found in high regions of high temperature. Cryo means cold, so these are found in the regions of low temperature or colder areas. So this is another classification for animals. Now let's move on to the last section for today's class, that is the Vavilov's classification for gene center. Now the complete detail of the gene center is available, as I said, in the postal course, where you will have each and every plant and animal species which originated in these gene center. So here we would be just talking about the concept of gene center propounded by Vavilov and the main essence of this theory. So Vavilov, what he tried to do was, he tried to propound the concept of gene center, and he said gene centers are the areas of origin or most widely cultivated areas in the geographical settings. So his classification led to division of the regions into 8 major criteria or 8 major categories. The first region that he talked about was Mexico-Guatemala region, or it is also known as the South Mexico region. This region is around 3500 BC old. The major activities that was common in this region was sowing, chopping. So that was the prominent activities that originated in this gene center. You have the huge list of plants and leguminous and grains species which originated in this gene center. The next is the Peru Ecuador. So you have the Peru region and the Ecuador region. So this was a kind of growth or gene center for South American region. The major elements here was starchy food, as I said, origin of sweet potato. Potato was common in South America. So starchy food was one of the major crux of this region. The next region he talked about was Mediterranean region, around 4000 BC old. This region is known for its unique characteristics of winter rainfall. The next region is the Middle East region. Now Middle East region is the oldest of all, around 10,000 BC old. It is known for its classic use of wooden plow, which was known as arad. It is further subdivided into regions of Southeast Asia. You have Middle East Asia and the Southeast East Asia here. So this region, as I said, is the oldest among all the gene centers. So it is kind of cradle for civilizations and cradle for the growth of various plant species. The next region is Ethiopian region, the region 5. It is also known as the African region or the Nile region. Again considered to be a very fertile region due to the Nile Valley civilization here and the river Nile here. This region is not that old. It's around 4000 to 5000 BC old. The major things here would be sheep, goat, and these were the major animals that were prevalent in this gene center. The next is the Central Asian gene center, including the parts of Mongolia, China, and northern India. It had its influence from the Harappan civilization and Mesopotamian civilization. Huge influence from Mesopotamian civilization. This is considered as another region which was a bit older region in contrast to the Neo-Arctic regions here, the Neo-Arctic and the Neo-Tropical regions here. It is known for its origin to various crops which were mainly based on irrigation. As this area, there was lot of development in the field of irrigation. The next is the Indo-Burma region, includes the whole of India along with the island groups of Indonesia and Java Sumatra. This region is known for the traditional crops like wheat and rice. The next is the region 8, which is the final region or the region of China. It was also known as the region which was the region of East Asia. It's around 6000 to 5000 BC old. Huge lot of water availability in this region led to development of crops mainly, which were more water consuming like rice. So with this we cover the various gene centers that were propounded by Vavilov and the concept and the distribution of plants and animals across the globe. We have covered the most of the topics in biogeography. In the next class we would be covering the topics related to climatology and geomorphology. You can subscribe to ExamReach channel for any further updates. Till then, have a good day.